All right, so good evening, everyone. Okay, we are here for the session 2 of 3. All right, so there are people who have joined who haven't joined for the first session. So for them, I'll give a quick overview of like how we are doing this. All right, so the thing is there's a wide range of participants. So more than half the people have mentioned that they don't have any prior experience. And so as a result, I'm giving some quick intro about HDLs, FPGAs, synthesis and verification. I have given it in the previous session. And throughout the 3 sessions, we'll be implementing 7 digital circuits. So we implemented the first one in the previous session. And we'll be implementing a few in this session. And through each example in this, so for each circuit, there will be the RTL code as well as the test bench code. It will be displayed on the slide. So you have to look at that and you have to type it and type it in Vivado or some editor, text editor, then save it and import that file into Vivado. So, and then you have to do simulation with that. So how to do these things, how to add things to Vivado, and how to add files to Vivado, and how to do simulation. For that, you can refer to these slides. I have given some videos. Okay, so in the slide 12, it's about how to create a Vivado project and add some files into it. And over here, this video is about how to do the simulation in Vivado. Okay, and this one is about slide 16 is about how to find the syntax bugs. Okay, so we went through this last time, in the last session. So if you have missed something, you can go back to those slides and look at it. So in the previous session, I went really slowly because most people were new. So I think you have got yourself familiarized with Vivado. So now we can pick up some speed and talk about a little bit advanced concepts. All right. So for each circuit, you'll be doing that. So you'll be copying the code and simulating it in Vivado, and you'll be checking the results and everything. So while you type the code, so I want you to type the code. There is a GitHub link also, you can get the code from here. But I want you to type it because each line, we are using different language features. Okay. So I want you to think about what those lines represent and how you can, so to get the idea. So after this, you should be able to write your own code for your own digital circuit. If you just copy and paste it, it'll be it's already there, but then you won't have the confidence to do it by yourself, right? Okay, so try to type the code by yourself. Then, so after that, we'll be simulating and we'll be synthesizing and we'll be looking at the results. Okay, so while you type the code, I will give you some time to type the code. While you type the code, I'll be answering your questions. Okay, so then I'll be moving back and forth in the slides. So because of that, keep these slides open. All right, so you can go to this link. And in this, if you go to the link, this will open something like this. And you can see the same slides are there. And keep this thing open. So even if I switch to a different slide, you can look at that and type it. Okay, another thing is you have to keep asking questions. So in the previous session, everybody kept asking a lot of questions, and I was answering everything, and that was why it took some time for each example. So but that's fine. So we definitely want that. You want to ask a lot of questions, so keep asking more questions. Okay, so ask them through this. So if you go to this link, okay, if you go to this link in your browser or phone or something, you will go to something like that. Okay, so in here you can go to, okay. So first thing is you can give us feedback. Okay, so if you are leaving in the middle or at the end or something, always give a feedback, everybody. Okay, each and every person who have come here, leave a feedback for every session. Okay, so first session like this, second session like this, you give feedback. And so you can ask the questions here. Okay, so the questions you ask will appear here. You can type your question and enter. It will appear here. and I can do this one. Yes. Okay. So these questions I will answer that. Okay. Right. So. Okay. So I will answer that when you write the like code, while others implement the circuits. Okay. Then another thing is like give feedback all the time. So use this link to ask questions and to give feedback. Okay. And you have the code in GitHub. Like in case if the code doesn't work, so that's like you have. If you look at the code from the slides and if you type it without any mistakes, it should work. I tested it. But in case you made a mistake and you can't find what's going on, like I won't be able to look at everybody's screen because there are 75 people. I can't look at everybody's screen. So what you do is like just leave it over there and go to the next example. Then get the code from GitHub and see where you made a mistake. Okay, right. And all right. So that's how we are going to do this. Okay. So let's start from where we stopped. Okay, right. So let me answer some questions before we move. Okay, so where can we find the recorded sessions? So I have sent everybody an email with a folder containing the recorded session. And if you haven't got an email or like if you can't check it, then check the Zoom chat. I have given a link. It's over there, right? Then NBIT adder test bench, it gives an error saying that STD is not recognized. Yeah, so that is a common error. Like if you do the synthesis, you might get it. And we'll do it now and we'll see, okay? Then okay, are there any syntactical differences when using quarters? Okay, so no, there are no differences in syntax. Okay, so in most cases there won't be. So like it's the same language. So you can use whatever you is there. Okay, so now let's go to the second example. Okay, so a quick recap. Like we built a 1-bit adder. Okay, so that's the first example. It's a 1-bit adder. So the idea is like, so it's what all you need to know is it's just a bunch of gates connected in a specific way. And what is a 1-bit adder? It adds two numbers and a carry and gives out a sum and a carry out. Okay, so basically it adds two bits, two single bits. So this is the building block of an actual N-bit adder. So like that's how you actually do addition inside the computer. So this is a full adder. All right. So now we did this and we did the simulation and all. Okay. Right. So now we are going to build a full N-bit adder. Okay. Okay. So we are going to build a full N-bit adder. Okay. So how does it work? So first one, let's look at the circuit. Okay. So the idea I'm going to introduce, the main idea I want to introduce in this example is basically how to use the previous modules. Okay, so how to do hierarchical design. That is you create one module, then you use it and build another module. You use that and build another module. How do you do that? Okay, so we have already built a fully working 1-bit adder and we tested it in the simulation. Okay, now we are going to use n number of those to make an n-bit adder. Okay, so here n equals 8. So 8 bits is 1 byte. So we are going to build an adder that adds 2 1-byte numbers. So what are 1-byte numbers? They are from 0 to 255. Okay, so we are going to add the 2 numbers and we are going to get an output. Right, so let's see how does it work? So this is the circuit of for the people who are new, the idea is we always go from the circuit to the code. Okay, so don't think in terms of code and write it because this is not a programming language. So we design the circuit and then write the code to match the circuit. Okay, right. So in this case, like we have the so we have the circuit like this of the n-bit adder. So each of these are full bit adder. Each of these are full adders. Okay, FA1, 0, FA1, FA2, up to FA7. There are 8 full adders. and we connect them in a specific way to make the n-bit error. So what is this way? We connect the, okay, we chain them. Okay, you connect the first one to second one, you chain them through the carry bits. Okay, so the carry out from the first one goes into the carry in of the second one. And we chain it that way and take the output. All right, and the sum, yeah. So the sum outputs, S0, S1, S2, S3, up to S7, this 8 of these, it becomes the output of this n-bit adder. Okay, so 8 of these become the output. So this is like the one of the simplest implementation of an adder. It's not very optimal. Okay, so I'm not teaching you how to design optimal modules here. I'm teaching you how to implement the modules you have created. So the optimal ways, there are this carry look ahead and some other like optimizations is done. I'm not going to talk about that. Okay, so first one. Now, how do we represent numbers in hardware? Okay, so like if you are representing, so if you are representing a number, say 0 to 255 or something, how do you represent that in hardware? We always represent it as a binary, zeros and ones, right? So there are these two ways of doing it. Okay, so one is, all right, so I'll talk about it in a moment. Okay. So we chain all this and do that. Now let's simplify this for a moment. Okay, so like we have 7 of these. If you simplify it, it becomes something like this, right? So we have FA0 up to FA7 from this zeroth bit of A and zeroth bit of B goes here, 7th bit of A and 7th bit of B goes there, okay? And we can say that the C0, like we can create a new wire called C, okay? And the C0 is connected to C in, and C1 is connected to the C out, and like that, and it goes out, okay? So if I simplify this, if I simplify this into one thing, that will be something like this, okay? So I have kind of made it abstract, okay? So AI, BI, CI plus one, CI and SI. This I goes from what to what? I goes from 0 to 7. When I equal to 0, you get this circuit, this one. Can you see? A0, B0, C0, C1 and S1, S0. Over here, when I equals 7, we get this 7, 7, 8, 7, 7. Okay. And I equals 0, I equals 1, I equals 2, I equals 3, up to I equals 7, we get all the different full bit adders, one bit adders, okay? And we chain them together using this C wire. And finally, we can make a, what? We, for example, we connect the I plus one of this one to the, yes. So this I plus one goes into the C in of the other one, okay? The one over here. So like that, we can chain it. So this is an abstract way of representing it. And this is what I'm going to talk about in here. Okay. So this is the code to do this. And let me talk about the code before we implement it. So like, okay. Now, first one, we have this parameter n. Okay. So So this means this is a parameterized module. Okay. What does that mean? That means we have n-bit full adder. So we are not constraining ourselves to say 8 bits or what, 3 bits or 4 bits or something. It is just n bit. So using this, you can change this parameter, say n16, n32, n8 or whatever, and you can automatically change like how many bits it can add. Okay, so that's called a parameterized module. And yeah, we are parameterizing this n. And then if you look at A, so A, B are two signals, okay? So A and B are two numbers, right? So what is this A and B? These are, we call it a vector, okay? So a vector is a collection of wires, all right? So in here, this vector A, okay? Vector A is a collection of how many wires? Of 8 wires, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 wires. And D is a collection of 8 wires, okay? So it's basically A is 8 bits and B is 8 bits. And the sum is also, we are taking it 8 bit. Okay. So it has to be 9 bits, but for the sake of like this example, I'm taking it as 8 bits. Okay. So A, B and S, all three of them are 8 bits in here. Right. So yes. Okay. Right. So what is this N minus 1, 2, 0? What does this mean? So this means this 8-bit wire, A, this 8-bit wire, like it goes, the indexing goes from 0 to N minus 1. So if N is 8, N minus 1 is 7. Okay. So it goes from 7 to 0. So why do we have, like, why do we write like this? So we write like this because this is a little endian number. Okay. So what is little, like little endian and big endian? What are they? So these are two types of representing numbers in the computer. All right. So the idea is like you have A is nothing but 8 wires. Okay. So if you have 8 wires, how can we represent an 8-bit number in there? So the first way to represent an 8-bit number is something like this. That is, we put so we write the number the same way we read into the bits, into the wires. Okay. The same way we read. So how do we read numbers? We read the numbers from left to right. Okay. So in any base. So for an example, in base 10, so when you say 4321, you write 4321. Okay. So the biggest number is on the left side and the smallest number is on the right side. Okay. So the ones places on the right side. So that is called the LSB, least significant bit. Okay. So the least significant bit is on the rightmost and that is called a little endian. Okay. You can also flip it on the other side and you can put the same thing on the other side. Okay. So you can read a number from right to left. So if you do that, then it's called a big endian. So you have to understand that these are just a bunch of wires and we are just putting these bits into those wires. Okay. So there's no inherent meaning to a number in a wire. Okay. You can read the way we define. So there are two ways we can define it. One is little endian, other one is big endian. So as a standard or as a convention, we always represent numbers. We almost always represent numbers inside any code, any hardware in little endian. Okay. So that is because that is the way we usually read numbers. Okay. So we usually read numbers this way. So we represent it in the same way. So we have the zero, the least significant bit on this side and the most significant bit on that side. Okay. So that is why we write it this way. See, N bit wire is declared as 0 to N minus 1. Okay. So 0 is the least significant bit. N minus 1 is the most significant bit. On the other hand, for some other purpose, but don't do this, but for some other purpose, if you want to do it as a big endian, we write it as 0 to N minus 1 the other way. Okay. For one particular wire. So this means the 0 is here and the N minus 1 is over there. It's the leftmost. All right. So, okay. Then, right. So A, B and S, we have three little endian wires of 8 bits. And another thing you see is like we write N minus 1 here. Why? Because that is the seventh wire. And this is the zeroth wire. So the indexing starts at 0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 7. Okay. Then, all right. Now look at, okay. Then we have the input logic Cin. Okay. So if you take this as one module, the whole thing as one module, can you see the inputs are A vector, B vector, C in, other inputs, and the outputs are this C out and all this but some vectors. Yes. Okay. So A like input logic C in, output logic S, and output logic C out. So these are the ports this module has. Now we are going to do something else. That is, we are going to define a new wire inside called C. Okay. I'm going to use this wire for chaining. Okay. So to connect this one to the input of the other one, and the output of that one to the input of the other one to do chaining. Okay, to do this. Okay, I'm going to declare a wire called C, and I'm going to connect C0 to the input of here and C1 to the output of here and the input of here. C2 to output of here and the input of here. C3 is here and here. So that this is a C wire. All right. So C wire has zero. C vector has how many wires? 0, 1, up to 8. So C vector has 9 wires. Okay. So these 9 wires I'm going to connect in this way, and they are named from 0 up to 8. All right. So that is this. Okay. So C is 9 wires. So that is what? If it is 8 wires, we say n minus 1. For 9 wires, we say n. N is to 0. Okay, n to 0. Then, yes, that's a vector. It's a n plus 1 bit little endian wire. Okay. So now we are going to do, okay. So now we are going to connect this, the C wires, 0th wire, the C vectors, 0th wire to C in. Okay, I have done this connection, sign, and this connection. C wires 8th one, that is N, C vectors nth wire, I'm connecting that to C out. Okay, I have connected this and this. All right, over here. Then what I'm doing here is what we are going to talk about. So like, that is the main purpose of this example. Okay, so what you see here is called, the first thing, this is what? It's a for loop. All right, so the for loops in here, it doesn't work like for loops in programming languages, because this is not a programming language. Okay, so in C or Python, you have for loops. And the idea is like, okay, like quick refresher, there is something called the control in programming language, which goes into the code, goes line by line. If there's a for loop, it runs here again and again, and then comes out. So that's called a control flow, and it happens in programming languages. It doesn't happen in what hardware description language. We saw that all these things are like kind of parallel. They are describing different wires and different connections. Okay, so this is not a programming language. Then why do we have a for loop here? So this for loop is called the generate for loop. Okay, why? Because it's inside a generate block, generate and ingenerate. Okay. And this for loop, what it does is basically it's a shorthand of what? Okay, so if this for loop is not there, what you have to do is you have to create this module. So we are creating a full adder. We have to write this code 8 times. You have to write this code once to create this one, another time to create another one. Like that, you have to write the same code 8 times to create what? To create this 8 adders. Okay, so and that is problem number one, is it's very hard, like it's tedious to copy it 8 times. The problem number two is you can't parameterize it. Okay, so that's like you have a 8 bit adder today, you want a 16 bit adder, then you have to open this code and you have to copy and paste it another 8 times, and you are bound to make mistakes. So don't do that. Okay, so instead of doing that, what we do is we use a for loop. So this for loop is basically like, it means repeat these lines 8 times. Okay, so it doesn't do any kind of like, there's no looping actually. This is like, we are creating a module here. I'm just telling repeat this creation 8 times. Okay, this instantiation is done 8 times. Okay. So n is 8. If you give n is 8, then that happens. Then you have, yes. So, yeah. So you can create n modules using a for loop. Okay. So that's how we create n bit adder. So how do we do this? Okay. So this is called a module instantiation. Okay. So previously we saw one module instantiation inside the test bench. Okay, so there we saw that if the port names and the wire names both are same, then you can use a wildcard dot star. Okay, but here they are not same. So you can't use a dot star. You have to do it the hard way. Okay, and the hard, that way is this. That is, I'm connecting the A input of the full adder. Okay, the full adder has an A input. I'm connecting that to AI. Okay, so this is the A input. I'm connecting that to AI. And the B input, I'm connecting that to BI over here. C in, I'm connecting this to CI. And C out, I'm connecting this to CI plus one. Okay. And yeah, sum. So the sum wire, I'm connecting that to SII. Okay. So this way, I'm connecting these wires to these particular locations. Okay. And I do this from 0 to 7. All right. So yeah. Okay. And here's the chaining is happening here. Can you see that? So CI, we connect the C0 to CIN, C0 to CIN, then C1 gets connected to the CIN of 0, and the 0, it goes there, and 1 comes out of C out of 0, and that is connected to the next one, to the input. And the output of that one is connected to the next one's input, and so on. And the final output comes out, and I connect that to CN as output. Okay, so that's chaining. Okay, so I'm introducing two concepts here. One is this generate for loops as well as chaining. Okay, so quickly type this. And yeah, so all right, I'll give you say 5 minutes, so 2-3 minutes, type it. So be quick. Okay, so there is somebody asked all the objects are created as FA, isn't it a problem? Okay, so first thing, it is not objects. Okay, so the name is instantiations. Okay, because there are objects in system Verilog, it has classes and objects, and that is something completely different. So these are modules and instantiations. And yes, it's a very good question. That is we are making everything of the same name, FA. So is that a problem? No, because we have something called, this is the generate loop. So generate, and we are giving it a name called add. Okay, I will show you in simulation how it happens. What happens is when you do this and simulate, it will create 8 different adders, and it will name the first adder as add FA0, and the second adder as add FA1. Third one has add FA2 and add FA4 and so on. Okay, so it will create the names automatically. So we just say FA, and after that it will automatically create add FA0, add FA1 and everything. Okay, that's done. Okay, what is the meaning of add? So I answered that question along with that. So add is basically a given, it's a name given to this particular generate loop, this for loop, and the actual names of these modules are created automatically as add FA0, add FA1 and everything. Okay, so when you declare C out to connect to CI plus one, shouldn't generate an error because CI plus one is not available. Okay, so that's not the case. Okay, it will not generate an error because, okay, what we are doing is always think in terms of circuit. Okay, so yeah. So don't think of this as programming. So think in terms of circuit. So it's not this is an array and you are calling the array the next element of the array. Okay, so C is a wire. All right, so although we call it a vector here, it's actually a wire, a set of wires. Okay, and we have created a set of wires here, and we have told, okay, we need 9 wires. from 0 to n. We have 9 wires, and those 9 wires are already created. And we are connecting this ith wire to this input and I plus 1th wire to the output. Okay, so 0th wire will be connected to the input of FA0, and first wire will be connected to the output of FA0. And that first wire will be connected to the input of FA1. Okay, so that's how we are doing the chaining. All right, so because we have already created the wire and we are assigning it to different places, okay, so it won't be an error. Okay. Okay, so what is dot A and dot B in the for loop? Now this dot A and dot B are not part of the for loop. Okay, they are part of the module instantiations. Okay, that is full adder FA. So this dot A and dot B are the input outputs of the full adder. So if you go back, or else I don't have to go back. I will show over here. Okay. Okay, so input logic A. So this is the input of, okay, this is the full adder module, which we designed already, which we built already. And dot A, dot B, dot C in, dot sum, dot C out. Okay, so these are the different inputs and outputs. And we are connecting these wires to the inputs and outputs of the full adder. All right, okay. Okay, so I think you have enough time of typing. Okay, so and what is the meaning of genvar? Okay, so genvar is a type of variable, okay, which we use like it'll be there in the data type slide. Okay, it's a type of variable we use in system A log. And what genvar means is this is only used inside generate loops. Okay, so what genvar means is it's a constant in compile time. Okay, so you can't assign values as you want to genvar. So over here I can't say genvar I equals 2 and genvar I equals something, like I can't just say I equals 2 and I equals 3 and everything. Okay, so we use this genvar only inside the for loops. So this is to tell the synthesis tool that, like, okay, so basically if you are using a generate for loop, use genvar. That's the simplest idea. Okay, so I will talk about it in detail in the data type slide. Okay, somebody has done this already and he says error ordered port connections cannot be mixed with name port connections. Okay, so I think that's a common error, and it does, but check this part, whether you have put a comma here. If you put a comma there, like, it will not work. Okay, so the last one should not have a comma. Okay, so I think you had enough time to type this, and let me do it just quickly. And all right, okay, so before we go, like, okay, so I will do the test bench and then I'll do that. Okay, so a test bench for the n bit full adder. Okay, so I'm taking like n equals 8, so this becomes an 8 bit full adder. And yeah, so the TB, okay. So what we are doing here is like, okay. So you know this part already, okay, time unit, time position, and we are creating a clock here, okay. So this initial block, it creates a clock, clock signal, okay, you know all that, right. And we know that the test bench module doesn't have any inputs or outputs because it's self-contained. It is the one who is creating input and giving to our signal. So similarly, we are doing this N, local parameter N, we are defining it here in the test bench, and we give this parameter to the adder. Okay, so N equals 8. Then, yeah, so we create A, B, and S wires. Okay, so A, B are inputs, S is output. But inside here, they are just wires, okay, inside test bench. And then we have the logic C in and C out. Okay, so now we can do this wildcard instantiation. Why? Because we have the same names of input as the N adder, A, B, S, and C in and C out. Because that is possible, because that, of that, you can say dot star. But you can't do this dot star for the parameters. Okay, okay. Now look at this. This is the syntax for the parameters. Okay. So now the parameter, you define it as hash, okay? So yeah, module N adder hash, and within brackets, we say parameter N. And here also we say N adder hash and this parameter, then your parameter name. Sorry, then you are like your module's name. So we usually use this DUT. DUT means design under test, okay? No, or device under test, yeah. So yeah, we use this this name, and so you can use any name you want, and we give the parameter and we give the inputs and outputs, right? Then what happens? We have this, okay, in the next initial block, we give different signals at different clocks, okay? At the each clock edge, we are giving different signals and we are looking at it. Now, okay, all this you know, okay? So you have done this before. That is like in the zero, in the very beginning, we are giving A5, okay. And this is something new, look at this. This is called, okay, this is a literal, okay. So here what we mean is, we say it's an 8-bit number, okay, 8-bit number. And D means it's a decimal number. This 5 is a decimal number, okay. So if you put O here, it becomes a octal number. If you put X, I think it becomes a hexadecimal. Yeah. So you can the 5 can be interpreted as octal, hexadecimal, or a decimal or anything. Okay. So we are telling it's a this one. So you don't have to do this actually. You can just put 5 instead of writing 8-bit D5. You can just put 5, and it will be read as a 32-bit decimal number. Okay, it will be read as a 32-bit decimal number. And when you assign this to A, it will take only 8 bits of that from the 32 bits. So if you are lazy, you can do that. Okay, but I'm just showing you that you can do this to be more precise. So 8 bits, decimal 5, then decimal 10. Okay, so we give 5 and 10 in the first clock. Yes. Okay. 5 and 10 in the first clock. Then we have, we give 30 and minus 10 in the second clock. And we give, 5 and this one in the next clock and the next clock. Okay. So now can you look at this part? Like, look at when you do the simulation, like you can see things happening like this. And look at this clock cycle. In the second clock, we are giving 30 and minus 10. When you give minus 10, the number you get is 246. Why? So most of you would know already. So because this is in 2's complement. Okay. The number like we give, that is like the minus numbers, negative numbers are represented as 2's complement. So I'm not going to talk about what 2's complement is. Okay. So you will learn that officially from the actual lectures. So the idea is like you have only 8 bits, so you can represent only numbers from 0 to 255. Okay, so what we do is we wrap the numbers around, so the minus 10 becomes 246. Okay, So if you want to read it as minus 10, you can right-click here on B and select signed integer. And you will see minus 10 there. Okay, right. So anyway, the beauty of 2's complement is, whether you give it as minus 10 or 246, it doesn't matter. It's the same. Okay, for this, whether minus 10 and 246 are the same in 8 bits. Okay, there's no difference. But when you give like that, if you add 30 and minus 10, you get what? If you do normally add it, you get 30 plus minus 10 is you should get 20. Okay, in 8 bits, if you add 30 and 246, you will get what? 276. But 276 is bigger than 255. Okay, so it wraps around and you get 20. Okay, so you add 30 and 246, you will actually get 20 in the output. And that is the number you get when you add 30 and minus 10. Okay, so which is why we say this minus 10 and 246 are the same, exact same. There's no difference, right? In 8 bits. So in 16 bits, it will be different. It will have some different number. Okay, so it's all about how we read it. Okay, then we have 5 and 10, and you get 6. Okay, we give 5, 10, and C in is equal to 1. Okay, so the sum you get is basically a sum of all 3. So you get 16. Okay, and in the next block edge, we are giving 127 and 1, and you get 128. Yeah, and yeah, now look at this part. This is the repeat loop. All right. So it's a repeat loop. In the repeat loop, what we do is, okay. So repeat 10 means we are going to repeat this 10 times. Okay. Then you begin that. And inside the repeat loop, you are telling at every positive edge, we are going to do something like this. We say randomize A and randomize D and randomize C. So what does this mean? Randomize A means you are... you are giving different values to A. Okay, so every positive edge, you will get a complete random value to A. And what is this inside A inside this? This means it's a constraint. Okay, we are telling, okay, I want to randomize this with A value inside here. You can tell minus 5 to plus 5. You can try it in the simulation now. Okay, minus 5 to plus 5, 0 to 10, 0 to 20. When you say that, you will get at every clock, you will get different values for A, which are within that range. Okay, so that's called a constraint randomization. And you can do that with system deadlock. All right, so what is this STD? STD is a namespace, just like in C, it's a namespace. And you can use the randomize function, which is already there to do this. Now, once again, look at this. This randomize is not synthesizable. Okay, so now it's like, if you think about it, it's obvious. Like, how do you do this randomize in a circuit? You can't. You have to design a very complex circuit to do a randomization. Okay, so because of that, like this randomize, you can't put it in a circuit. If you can't put it on a circuit, that is not synthesizable. Okay, but we are doing a test bench here. So inside test bench, we can use all these. You can put a delay. Okay, you can put a delay, you can put randomize, and all this we do inside a test bench to test the circuit. But we don't put this inside the circuit itself. All right? Okay. So, and you get, for at each you get an output. Okay? Right. So, So I want to show you these radix and signal colors. So let me show you quickly. There is a full ladder we have here. Let me copy and paste from. Okay, then add a TB. In Vivado, you add those files. Okay, add the design constraint, and I'm going to add in header. Finish. Then I'm going to add the simulation. Okay, design sources. And simulation file, I'm going to add the test bench. Okay. Then we are going to say in adder and in bitter. Yeah. So I'm going to set, okay. Now I want to simulate this one. If I simulate now, I will simulate the full adder. I will not simulate the n adder. So like to simulate n adder, I had to make this the top module. Set as top. Inside simulation. Okay, don't set it inside here. Inside simulation. Okay, and simulation sources. Then you run it. Look at questions. Okay, there's a lot of question. Okay, right. Once you get this one. Oh, okay, so one thing, look at here. Okay, look at here. Now, okay, that goes for too many cycles. Now, if you want to run like for some extra cycles, you can put here and you can say run. Okay, you can run the simulation like this. Okay, so now I'm going to zoom in here and we see this, right? Okay. So now for in this one, okay, so A, B, okay. Now these three, if I want, I can represent them in signed integer, okay? So the same numbers as signed integer. For that, you can right click, say radix, signed decimal, okay? So you can see the numbers in signed decimal. Or else I can show, but I can do this in hexadecimal. So if this is an address, if this is an address bus, then we would like to see it in hexadecimal usually. So you can do hex, okay? So you can see 0051E057F78, okay? These are hexadecimal numbers. The same number becomes hexadecimal. Octal, the same number, 005177, the same number becomes octal, okay? And I'll go back to sign decimal again, right? And the signal colors, you can choose a signal color here. Okay, so don't use red and blue because those are actual things. Like red is for unconnected wires, blue is for blue is for unconnected wires, red is for unassigned wires. So you can use yellow. Okay, so and different colors like that. Okay, then if you want, you can put a divider or groups. Okay. So a new divider. Okay, so inputs. And so Cin is an input. Then you can put, say a group. And you can put things inside a group. It out. You can delete the groups. You can name these outputs or something. And you can delete these wires if you don't want. Delete. Ah, okay, so one more thing, like this is something important. You can, okay. So when we are debugging this, so why do we do this? There's a circuit. Oh, sorry. Why do we do the waveform? Because we want to see what are the inputs and outputs, right? So that is to debug, to find mistakes, find errors. Now, let's say you have an error in the output. Okay. So let's say you have an error in the sum. Here you have an error. So you don't know why that error is there. So then what you can do is you can go inside the modules and you can check the intermediate wires, okay, which are not visible here. How do you do that? To check the intermediate wires, look at here. This nadder TB is the top module, the TB module, test bench module we created. Inside that DUT. DUT is the n-bit adder module, 8-bit adder module. If you click this, it will open all the submodules inside. Okay, so can you see here? Add 0 FA, add 1 FA, add 2 FA. Okay, so these are the FA modules we create. That is the full adder modules. We created in a for loop. and we give the name FA, and the FA comes here. All right, and we gave the, for the for loop, we gave the name add, and add comes here. All right. So what you can do is you can click on this DUT, and when you click on this DUT, you can see the signals of the DUT. So if you have some additional signals here, you can select that, or else you can go inside, you can pick a particular adder. Say I want to look at the second adder, add two, and you have the A, B, C in, sums and C out, different things of that particular wire. And you even have the wire one, wire two, wire three. Can you see that? Why, what are these? These are the intermediate wires in the full adder circuit. Okay. So you can actually open up your N bit adder and you can see these particular wires, wire one, wire two, and wire three, which are inside the each particular full adders. Okay. So let's see, I want to look at the wire one, wire two, wire three of the what, the second adder. You drag them here like this and leave it. Okay. Leave it. And what you do is you click this to relaunch the simulation. Okay. So because when you add the wire, it doesn't show you the wire waveform. Okay. You have to simulate it again to see the waveform. So this is how we find the bugs in our design. So what we do is we get the intermediate signals out, and then we simulate it again and see whether the intermediate signals are correct. If they are wrong, we go back and check the signals they are coming inside to that. And like that, we keep on going back until we find the particular place where we made a mistake. Then we go to the design and change that and simulate it again to see whether we have solved the mistake. Okay. So that's how we do the debugging usually. All right. So here we can see the intermediate wires, wire one, wire two, wire three of, okay, of what? If you just hover over there, it will give the address. See, of add the two wire one. Okay. So of the add two module. Okay. So that's how you do the simulation. And okay, so right. So Redis colors. Okay, that's all. So let's move on to the next one quickly. And okay, before that, the questions. Okay, so let me answer some questions quickly. So that is, okay, so meanwhile, okay, I'll ask you to type this and answer those. Okay, so what you have here is, okay, this example, third example, we are going to implement a combinational ALU, okay? So this is a kind of an inefficient form of ALU. What is an ALU? ALU is an arithmetic logic unit, okay? So that is inside your processor, inside the computer processor, or inside any processor, say Arduino processor, you have Admega chip. So in there, you have something called an ALU, which is doing the calculations, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, okay, modulo, all these things. So it's okay. So usually we connect two buses, A bus and B bus to there and get the output and everything. So I think, yeah, so you guys will be, our guys will be designing this processor in semester five. So in semester five, like inside the processor, you will have to create an ALU. And the ALU is like maybe the simplest thing in the processor, okay, because other things are more complicated. So in ALU, what happens? You give two inputs, A and B, okay? And you give a selection bit. You give a certain bit. And this bit says what you want to do with A and B, okay? So like if you give a particular number, it will add and give out. If you give another number, it will subtract and give out. Multiplication, division, everything you can give like that, okay? And Z is a zero. So, okay, so Z is a flag. Okay, so usually ALUs have flags. You can omit it if you don't want it. But, okay, so the idea of a flag is whether when C becomes zero, this Z goes up high. Okay, so what is the purpose? What is the practical use of it? So there is no use here in our example, but in actual ALUs, we usually have a lot of flags, a lot of zero flags. And the reason for that is we use those flags to do jumps. So jump is basically how an if else or like a for loop or while loop, these loops happen. Loops as well as if else conditions happen inside a processor. Okay, so it goes to some particular point and then it does a comparison and see whether the result is zero. If it is zero, it runs another instruction. If it is not zero, it runs another instruction. So that's basically if and else. Okay, so yeah, you don't have to worry about it now, but that's the idea of a flag. Flags are used for jumps, and jumps are used for conditional, like if else and while loops and everything in programming. Okay, so that's how as a processor works. Right. Now, all right. So how does it, how does this work? Now, this particular thing, before you write the code, you have to make the circuit. You have to draw the circuit. So this is the circuit. Always think in terms of circuit. So you have A bit, A vector and B vector, and the zero, and the same vector, same A vector and same B vector are given to all these different modules. So what are these different things? Okay, so you do addition, you do a subtraction, you do a multiplication, division, and this modulo. All right, now look at this carefully. So here is one important distinction from a programming language. So in a programming language, you can say if cell is zero, then do add. If you do that, what happens? If you do that, the processor will check whether it's zero. And if it is zero, it will quickly do an addition. Only the addition. It doesn't do anything else. Okay. And then it will go to the next statement. But here the problem is in hardware, like when you are making hardware circuits, in the circuit, everything has to happen in parallel, right? So because it has to happen in parallel, you have to have separate hardware for addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and this one. All of this, you need to have separate hardware, okay? So we put all separate hardware, like 4 or 5 of these modules like this, okay? So addition, subtraction, this one, and we give A and B to all of them. Then what happens? At every moment, this adder will calculate the addition. This will calculate the subtraction, multiplier will calculate multiplication, division, and this is modulo. Okay, so it will calculate all of this in parallel. That is in the same time. Okay, so like it'll be happening all in parallel. Then what we do, we use a multiplexer. So this is a multiplexer. We use a multiplexer to select one of these and give us an output. Okay, so how do you select with the multiplexer? So if the select is zero, then we select the plus addition. This is one, we select subtraction. If it is 1, 0, that is 2, we select multiplication, division, and modulo, like this. And if it is none of these, if this is something else, then we select what? We select A. Okay, so that's just a design. You can design as you want. Okay, so right. So this is how we do it. So all of this happens in parallel from the output. All of these have different outputs. We select one particular output and then we give it. So that's how we have designed this ALU. Okay. So let's see how we build this. Okay. So you know parameter and width is 8 bit. Okay. So which means this ALU, you can use it for 16 bit, 32 bit or whatever number of bits. Okay. So because we have parameterized it. Okay. So input logic cell. Okay. Now cell is 2. Why do I say 2? 2 to 0. This means cell is 3 bits. Cell is a 3 bit number. Why do I say 3 bit number? Because there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different operations this ALU can do. So I need 3 bits. That is 8 different numbers. 2 to the power 3 is 8 different numbers to represent these 5 different operations. Okay, so that's why I'm using a 3 bit. Okay, now look at this. This is something called the signed. Okay, so look at this one. This is input logic signed and input logic signed. Okay, A, B, and C. Okay, so previously we have seen only input logic. So now this is called a signed vector. So what is the difference? There is no difference. Okay, so there's absolutely no difference between a signed vector and unsigned vector. They are the same thing because they have 8 wires inside, and the 8 wires have different now what values, but and if you put signed or not unsigned, it doesn't matter. Okay, but so there's absolutely no difference between signed A and just A, but the difference comes when you want to assign this to a bigger number or assign this to a smaller number. Okay, so let's say there is another vector, another set of wires which are bigger than this 8 bits. So that is like a 16 bit wires, 16 bit, like different lines of wire. and you want to connect this 8-bit wire to the 16-bit wire. Okay, so what do you do? And so what you ideally want is you have an 8-bit number, you want to represent that in 16 bits. That's what you're trying to do, right? By trying to connect these two things. You are trying to represent the 8-bit number to a 16-bit number. If you, I will show an example later. If you do that without signed, if you don't put a sign there, if A is unsigned, so if you don't put this signed, A becomes an unsigned vector. If it, A is unsigned, when you connect these two, what happens is the least significant 8 bits are connected to the 16 bits, and the other 8 bits are all zeros. The higher bits are zeros and the bottom bits are connected. Okay, now that works very well if your number is unsigned. Okay, but what if your number is signed in 2's complement? Okay, so the people who know 2's complement, who have studied 2's complement before, so they know that, okay, if you have a negative number in 2's complement, the first bit have to be negative. Okay, and if you are assigning that to a bigger number, assigning 8-bit number to a 16-bit number, you have to make sure everything else, all the other 8 bits are ones, not zeros. If it is a negative number. Okay, otherwise, like it'll be a mistake. Okay, the number will change. If you don't put all ones, the number will change. Okay, so I'm not going to talk about it much because that is like, you will learn it over there. But the difference is if you put signed, it automatically does that. It automatically fills the other ones with ones for negative numbers, and it automatically fills the other ones with zeros for positive numbers. If you do unsigned, it will not do that. It will just put zeros. Okay. So, all right. So in Verilog, it doesn't have a signed type, I think. So in our projects, what we did was we had to manually put ones and manually put zeros and everything. In System Verilog, you don't have to do that. It takes care of it by itself. You just have to name it as signed. Okay, so output logic Z, then you have always comb, and you have if and, okay. All right, look at this. Now this is a if else condition, okay? So it's a nested if else. If, else if, else if, else if, else if, else. Okay, right. So and so if cell is equal to 0, then output C is equal to A plus B. If it is 001, it's A minus B, A into B, A divided B, like that. Okay. Now see, first of all, this if else statement creates a multiplexer. Okay. So don't think of it as it's not programming language. So don't think of it in the same way you think of if and else in programming. Okay. So the idea is a multiplexer is created here. Okay. So the idea is first you design this circuit. If you want a multiplexer, you use if statement. Okay, so that's how you have to do it. Okay, don't open the editor and then think about like of this one. Okay, so if you need a multiplexer, you use an if statement like this. Okay, then so somebody asked me before with what is the difference between assign and always comb? Okay, so this is the difference. Okay, so inside an always comb, you can put something like this, if statement, else statements, and all these things. Okay, and see if this is equal to 0, C equals that, C equals that, C equals that, C equals that. Okay, so you are creating a multiplexer. You are assigning different values to C based on cell. Okay, so you can do this inside always comb. You can't do this in an assign statement. You can, there's something called the ternary operator, but that is not readable. That's like, it looks more complicated. So this is a better way to write it. They are both the same thing. Okay, so then that's an advantage of always comb. All right, now the thing is this if else is what? So one way to implement a multiplexer is if else. Okay, but this is not a very good way. Why? You have to write the same thing again and again. You have to say cell equals this, cell equals this, cell equals this. Okay, it's very hard. So an easier way and a much better way of writing this is called this. Okay, this is the same code as before. Okay, so same code, the only difference is this one. The if else statements, I have replaced it with unique case. Okay, so this is a case statement. So people who have done C, they have seen this kind of statements, switch case and everything. So Verilog has something similar. That is case, you take a select, okay, cell. If the cell is 0, then C is this. If the cell is 1, then C is this. cell is 2, C is this, 3, C is this, like that. And default means else. In if else, you have the default. So that is like, if cell is other than any of this, then the output is C equals A. Okay, right. Now, what is this unique? Okay, so this case statements, there are two types of case statements in system Verilog. In Verilog, there is only one type of case statement, there is a case. In system Verilog, there are two types of case statements, unique case and priority case. And here we are looking at the unique case. So by telling this unique case, we are telling the synthesize tool, okay, I need this in parallel. Okay, so all these things should happen in parallel, like this. Okay, so all these things should happen in parallel. It, you should select from one of these from the parallel. And you are telling that all of these are completely mutually exclusive. Okay, these selection bits are mutually exclusive. We are telling this. Then other one is priority case. So priority case is something like if else. Okay, so this is a kind of a priority case. Look at this. So the priority is given to the first statement. Okay, so first you check this, and if that's not there, then you check this, then you're not there, then you check this, like that. In unique case, you take the cell and you check all of this at once. Okay, so that's fully parallel. Usually the synthesize tool will decide what is better for you, whether like unique this or what, whether to use priority or use the other one. But that can be a problem. For the newbies, don't worry about it. For the experienced people, it can be a problem. So the idea is like, if you put a priority case, or like if you do something like this, it might create a very long path inside. Okay, because it checks this, then it goes checks that, then checks that, like that. So if you don't want to do that, if you want to force, I want parallel, then you have to write the case as unique case. Okay, so this is unique case. Right. So I think you guys have typed this. Okay, so I will answer a couple of questions. Wait. Okay, so I will answer a couple of questions before we move on. Okay, why do we have a delay element there in the test bench? So test bench is, okay. So because we want to, okay. This delay element, okay. So this is there to make sure to create the clock. To create the clock, clock period is 10. So 10 by 2 is 5. After 5 nanoseconds, you switch it. You toggle the clock. Then after 5 nanoseconds, you toggle the clock. So like that, you keep toggling the clock after 5 nanoseconds. So that is the forever loop. So it goes on forever. So the idea is like you start at 0, then you delay 5 nanoseconds. You wait for 5 nanoseconds, then toggle it. Then come back here, wait for 5 nanoseconds, toggle it. Come back here, wait for 5 nanoseconds, toggle it. So this hash 5, it means you have to wait for 5 nanoseconds. Okay, so that's a delay statement. And yeah. Is it synthesizable? Can I use any C++ namespace here? No, you can't. Don't do that. So STD is the same name is there in C++ as well, but they are different. They're not the same. Okay. So now this is Verilog, system Verilog STD namespace. Okay. You can use only that one. Okay. You can use only the system Verilog namespaces. Can you please repeat about how to relaunch simulation to show intermediate outputs? Okay, so let me quickly show that. Okay. Okay, the person who asked that question, look at it here. So if you want to relaunch the simulation to show intermediate outputs, you open this module, go inside and go to any particular circuit and say 6. I'm taking the wire 2 of 6. Okay, so these two are, this is of at 6. This is of at 2. They are two different separate wires. Then you click here. This is the relaunch simulation. You can add whatever you want from there. Okay. You can drag, click and drag and drop from there. And then you select this and you will what that waveform will be computed. Okay, then are we assigning the Cin to Cout to first and last vector of the wires twice? No, we are not. Okay, so yeah. So you can see this wire and this wire are not same because they belong to different modules. Okay, so are we adding assigning Cin and Cout the first and last? No, we are not. Okay, now we are not. So we are not assigning the Cin and Cout to the first and last of the vector wires twice. No, we are not. This Cin and Cout are the ports of the big module, the big n-bit adder module. Okay, in adder, the input port and the output port, Cin, Cout. But this Cin and Cout, this Cin and Cout are the ports of the full adder module, one-bit full adder. Okay, this is the n-bit adder. So we are connecting the input Cin and Cout of a full adder FA module to these wires, the intermediate wires. Okay, and we are not connecting the Cin and Cout twice. Okay, so if you look at this, the C0 is connected to Cin. The C0 is not connected anywhere else. Okay, yeah. Okay, so. We create the N adder under design sources. Yes, you create the N adder under design sources. So not simulation. And the N adder test bench you created in the simulation. Then hashtag for parameters. Yes, hashtag is only for parameters. Yeah. So we used the hashtag for parameters here. And it is also used for delay in here. Okay, but they are like completely different places. One is here and one is there. Here and there, so it's the same hashtag, but they mean different things. So here it means delay. Here it means parameter. Okay, then what is the difference between wire and logic? That's a good question. Don't use wire. Okay, so wire you can use it because it's there in Verilog. It is there in System Verilog also. You can use wire, but use wire only if you want to assign multiple outputs to a same wire. We don't do that often, okay? So because like usually wires have only one driver, okay? So there's only one module which is assigned into a wire. So in that case, use only logic, don't use wire. But in case you want to have multiple modules writing the same wire, if you are an advanced designer and if you want to have it, so that's called a tri-state wire, okay? So for that, you can okay, hello. Yeah, so sorry about that. There was a problem with my laptop. Okay, so somebody asked. Okay, so the thing is like somebody asked like whether we can get a 10-minute break. Okay. All right. So we are running out of time, but like I'll give a break. Okay. So you can come back at 8:30. That's fine. Okay.